My watch is right on the half hour, so I can just pick it up.
Mine is too,
from
yeah.
The, from the,
4:30.
So just say go and then push start and go, okay?
Okay, we have speed.
What does that mean?
I get it. So when I say go, you talk.
Okay.
Go.
Well, again we meet, sir, on the battlefield of good jokes and good cheer in a season of good cheer being the Christmas holiday season.
Wait, welcome, this is the Christmas holiday season?
Yes,
it is. Harold.
There's a thing called Hanukkah. There's a thing called Christmas.
Hanukkah.
A lot of people go out in sleighs and everybody slaps everybody else. And they eat turkey.
Let me ask you, like, do you really like the holiday season, Harold?
Yeah, I do.
Why?
I remember as 5-year-old, it was just like the greatest thing in the possible world.
Did you get any gifts or anything?
Yes.
What kind of presents and gifts did you get?
Toy guns.
Where are they?
Books.
I need them now.
I got a lot of books. A lot of books that I could read.
Really?
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
Fabulous. I never got anything, Harold.
I think the best thing, do you want to know what the best thing I mentioned?
What was it?
First of all, you don't remember very well. This is getting philosophical and all that. But one doesn't remember terribly well when you're a youngster of, say, 5 or something like that.
You remember when you were 5 years old?
No, I don't really. Do you?
I remember when I was born, Harold.
Well, that's really something.
Yes, I remember flying into the hospital.
Stop the presses. He remembers being born.
Harold, I remember flying into the hospital and deciding which baby to go into. I picked the wrong baby with the wrong family.
You got good stuff for a new religion?
See, if I knew
a
where
new
you
religion,
were... If,
you'll make out like a
If I knew where you were, Harold, I would have looked for you.
No, well, I'm sure you would have, because kindred spirits. Right?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah,
that's
imps. Right. Yeah, right.
That's right.
But the one I remember most, I was about 10. And, you know, well, I don't want to get morbid or anything, but my daddy died when I was only 10.
10 years old?
Yeah.
How old was your father?
I was 48. And that was the average age for a male born in the United States of America was 48.
Wow.
Through science and through the beginning of the gathering of knowledge and good work and all of that kind of thing, plus the infrastructure needed
Terrible.
And all that,
yeah.
The lifespan has been increased by about 30 years.
30 years.
From 48. He was 48.
Harold.
Now it's 78.
Harold, my father passed on when he was 57.
Well, that's
57, all right. And my grandmother lived to be 107.
Wow.
And she used to go to doctors all the time,
yeah.
Take off all of her clothes when she was 105 and say, "Hey, doc, aren't I beautiful?" Aren't I beautiful?
Yeah, right. Now, that's the kind of heritage that I think is worth really considering.
Yeah.
But anyway, I was about 10, and it was awful. But anyway, but that I remember, in that or maybe in the year after, it was when I got what was called a wizard.
A wizard? What is that?
Oh, gosh. Everybody in Michigan, where I lived in Detroit, all but 10, 12 years old or something, everybody had what was called a wizard. I don't know what's happened to it. It was the greatest thing
since
sliced bread.
What is it? What?
It was like a Schwinn bike with a serious motor.
Okay.
And you could just go 60, 70 miles an hour on that
what?
Sucker.
Really?
And it was, you could get around. You had mobility.
Oh, it had a motor.
Yes, it was a motorbike. A wizard. W-I-Z-Z. I think it's still in business.
Wow.
But it was a wonderful thing. And everybody of that age in that era had a wizard. And you got mobility.
Mobility. The gas was only, what, 15
About 10 cents
a gallon? 10 cents, 15
cents
a gallon.
It was incidental.
It was fabulous.
Yeah, right. And that was such a thing. And I used to go to a school outside the suburbs in Detroit.
Yeah.
And would go to that school on my wizard. See, when you get mobility to be able to move, that's a big thing, I think, for a lot
Harold,
of people.
Harold,
I've always wanted to be able
to. You come from Detroit. I come from Chicago.
Yeah.
All right. Now,
city.
I used to deliver papers. I had to get a bike. All right. And the thing is
that
I had to get a subscriptions to get a free bike because I had no money. So I got a free bike, a Higgins bicycle.
I had a bike before I had the wizard.
Yeah, yeah.
But that was something, and I had to deliver papers, free press.
Yeah,
and I would go down with 60, you had to fold them and they're in a bag.
You roll it up with the rubber band, throw it at the people.
You throw it up on certain things who have subscribed.
I know.
At the end of the month, end of the day, a week, you have to go and collect the money for 45 cents for a weekly subscription.
That's right. That's right.
A delivery boy.
It was a fortune.
Yeah.
A fortune in those days. I used to work for 15 cents an hour.
Hmm. 15 cents. You hear that, young men? You're all getting $5 an hour and complaining?
Yeah, 15 cents an hour. Then it went up to 35 cents an hour when I was... Oh, wait, it used to be 25 cents an hour when I was delivering chickens, kosher chickens.
Give them an inch of the oil.
Listen,
take
I used
mile,
to...
mile those people.
Harold.
Those poor people. They'll I used to deliver kosher chickens for
a guy named Perlman. He used to wrap up all the chickens in a newspaper all the time, roll it all up. I used to deliver the chickens, all right? I think I got... The customers used to open up the chickens, and they take the chicken, they smell it under this arm, the ladies. They spread the legs, they smell it in
Cut
the middle.
It out now.
I'm
You're
telling you... No, and the women used to say, this chicken stinks.
Yeah.
And I used to tell them, lady, can you pass a test like this? And then I had a fight to get my quarter tip.
Yeah.
I had to get a quarter tip.
Quarter.
I said, I can't leave you the chicken unless you give me a quarter tip. I must have the quarter tip. I got a quarter tip all the time.
There's 45 cents for the 7 days a week delivery, including the Sunday with all the comic books, Archie. And
everything.
And it was 45 cents and you get a nickel tip.
I used to get a quarter because
they were
kosher chickens. Mm. Kosher chickens you get more money for.
Yeah.
If it was non-kosher chickens, you get less money. So I made sure that it was kosher.
What makes the kosher chicken kosher?
I don't know. Clean.
What
it's called clean. Clean.
Sugar?
All they do is they dip it. They probably dip the damn thing in salt water and they dip it and dip it and dip it and dip it and that's it.
We could make a soft shoe. What? makes a kosher chicken salsa, and we can do a dance or something, you know,
I'm
like
telling
that.
You, that's right.
Do you dance? Do you dance? I used to teach
over at Dale's Dance Studio many years ago.
Yeah.
And I used to teach ballroom dancing.
Oh, could you do ballroom?
Yeah, I do ballroom
waltzes
dancing.
Waltzes and stuff?
I have a bronze medal for ballroom dancing.
I have a bronze medal for being a ballroom canier.
I know you do. I know you do because one of the shows we saw, it was beautiful.
I know.
But it wasn't bronze, it was gold. Wasn't it gold?
Golden color, it wasn't bronze.
Well, maybe they plated it gold.
That medal that weighs heavy and everything is in the Library of Congress in honor.
Yeah.
That's gold.
Yeah, that was
but
wonderful.
But these are copies of it and everything.
Oh.
And you see the new comic book? It is stripping everything. It's a lady.
Yeah.
Borinka Nera or somebody.
No, I
didn't. Character. They were just the Puerto Rican, Latin American, a lot more. It's a great new comic book that's coming out. It's just hit the press. Just this last week.
Are you mentioned in the comic strip?
Of course not. I'm not.
Why?
Because the heroine of the thing is a woman who's like a Borinka Nera.
You should have been mentioned.
Or they're trading on the Borinka Nera name. That's the name of the tribe that was there when Columbus came.
I know. You were there. It was fabulous.
I wasn't there when the Columbus came.
You weren't there during the time of Columbus?
No, I was not.
Harold, why not?
I was a dream in somebody's mother's Christmas.
You were a pipe dream, a pipe dream then.
Pipe dream.
You know, I had my own TV show many years ago in the Merryworth comic strip that ran for a whole year all over the world.
Really?
Over
the world?
Yeah, all over the world. Danny Darrow.
Global distribution.
Danny Darrow, I was in there with my...
They use your name?
Yeah.
And they had a caricature?
I was the caricature, I was the name, everything for a whole year in
Merryworth
comic strip.
Major.
It was years ago.
Yeah. God, you carried so well. You look like you're about 30 years old. You're
30 years old?
What have you done to stay so young and vibrant and healthy and all
Harold,
that?
Harold, I've been cut up 20 times, had about 20 operations. My heart, my feet... But I'll tell you something. I don't know how I look, but I'll tell you one thing. Mm. The container, I need a new container, Harold. Because the container is wearing out.
Wear and tear.
Harold, how is your container, Harold?
It's getting a little bit rusty.
Yeah, rusty. We have to spray it with motor oil, maybe.
I'm going to be 82, I tell you.
You're going to be how old?
82.
God bless, 82?
I
think I'm 79 now.
Oh, you're just a punk kid.
A punk kid?
Yeah. Right.
A punk kid. You're a punk kid at 82.
You should come and listen to me, because I'm a senior, and you should honor your seniors, right?
Harold.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you're okay, I've seen you. You look damn good at 82.
Well, it's a facade.
It is a facade? All right, don't anybody believe this. All right, he's lying about his age. Lying about his age.
All right, I'm
you're really, he's really 106. 106.
Jack Benny stayed 39 for about 40 years.
Well, what do you, you know, he didn't leave the house.
No, I know. Anyway, it is the season of that and everything like that, and it's good to see you and everything. And are you all set for, do you celebrate Hanukkah or Christmas?
I don't celebrate anything.
Bah humbug. Are you a bah humbugger?
I'm a bah humbugger.
Harold,
I don't celebrate.
Bah humbug.
I don't celebrate anything. I hide. I hide.
You hide.
Somebody looks for me, I'm not there.
Well,
I'm not there. I'm hiding all the time.
That's a good strategy.
Of course it is. Why should I be bothered?
For living off a long time. Yeah.
Well, I'm doing the best I can.
Good.
What about you?
Well, I don't want to go into my personal life. I got some problems and so forth. But anyway.
You know, let's not discuss them.
I don't want to go into that.
But what about the holidays? Harold, what about the holidays, Harold?
Well, when I was 10 years old or something, or 12 or something, when my daddy went and everything, I got that wizard. That was the best prize I ever got in my life.
It a motorbike.
It gave you mobility.
Yeah.
I think men like that more than women.
No, motorbikes are fabulous. Yeah. Fabulous
thing. This was the thing. It was really everybody had one. And then they would tinker in the garage and fix the carburetor and all that. It was
fabulous.
Really, it was a great era. Era like that.
Yeah, but do you remember what the cost was of that motorbike? Remember?
No, it was quite a bit. It was quite a bit.
In those days.
Yeah, but for those, everything suggested that way. It was a pretty big thing. My mother must have done a lot of, she was the best mother in the history of the universe, but did some to get it and everything. But then I used to go to a school out on what's called Northwestern Highway in Detroit, out in Southfield.
How many miles was
that? Well, that would have probably been about, I'm trying to think, probably would have been about 12, 15 miles.
Went on the Whizzer on the motorbike.
Not only would I go on the Whizzer and the Whizzer on the motorbike, I had it down to where that motorbike, I would sit on the motorbike. It's winter, okay?
Okay.
Get the picture.
Okay, I get the picture. Did you have snow tires on the motorbike?
No.
No snow tires?
Regular old tires.
Okay. You
know? But they were solid. It was solid. It was a good thing. I think it could have a great role to play in the modern world. But in this world. But I used to go out there to that school and everything. And I would go out Northwestern Highway, which is a major highway, snow, sleet, hail, whatever. You're young, you don't care about that stuff. And everything. And I used to put my hands in my pocket and go, no hands.
While you were riding the motorbike?
I was riding the motorbike, and it's a motorbike. It's an actual bike.
You took a lot of chances, Harold.
Well, yeah, but I knew I was okay.
You did?
Yeah, I knew.
But the bike didn't know you were okay.
The bike didn't need to know. I knew. And that's the thing that is got a metaphor in there for something. But I used to, you could just, you had a throttle and, you could control it and everything by holding the handlebar.
Yeah.
And I would just sit back on the bike and just steer it with my knees. And it's just going by itself.
Yeah.
And I had such a liaison with that machine.
Yeah.
It was really, I had complete control. Never had any problem.
What happened?
You could just ride it no-handed. No-handed, they would call it.
Wow. You know, they have a car.
Put my hands in hands in my pocket.
They have a car now. Well, you don't even need a driver.
It's coming. They just tested it, and they got fined because somebody ran through a red light.
Yeah.
But that's always the start of something.
Yeah.
It's coming.
Yeah. No driver, no nothing. It's just a car.
Yeah, I know.
So pretty soon we're going to have big problems with the people that want to get rid of this country. They're going to put bombs in it and everything else. No driver, no nothing. They're going to drive it right into us and let it explode.
I think they're going to have delivery to your door. They're going
to
end
delivery
up,
to your door. When are they going
to
deliver,
not
Harold?
To your door. You know what you're going to get? You used to have a thing called a milk, a door. It was, they would put milk in there
from outside,
and you could get it from inside. You could open.
Yeah.
So they're probably going to come up with something like that where anything you want, pizza or anything or whatever, items, they'll have drones. They'll have drones that will deliver that. So it's already starting to happen.
Yeah.
The drones will deliver direct to your door.
Well,
you don't need to have no more paper boys, no more people wanting a tip at Christmas. That'll be great for the misers. You know,
be great for misers, but the people are going to be out of work.
How are they going to? Those poor people, there's 62 people. in the world. The wealth of 62 people in the world is equal to half the population of the world.
Wow.
It's a true fact. 62 people.
That's right.
That's
right.
What you would call.
And are they running the world, Harold?
Yes,
they're running
exactly.
The world, aren't they?
And 65% of
they're
the
trying
budget,
to.
65% of the budget is military, and it's growing. And they're going to refurbish and get stronger the Trident submarines in the American atomic thermal nuclear fleet,
which is
a major threat to the world.
Did you see the new submarine that they made?
No.
Tell me about it. It looks like a. It looks so strange. It's all straight lines.
Yeah.
Straight lines, and it's atomic.
Atomic,
right?
Atomic submarine. Oh, yeah.
Submarines. Well, and you don't see any guns. You don't see anything on it at all. It looks like it's like a stealth fighter.
Uh-huh.
And that's how they.
Well, that's streamlined. Yeah,
they have
in,
one.
In water
I don't know.
Or air.
Yeah, I don't know what that. I can't remember what they paid.
Trillion doesn't matter.
$1 billion.
All being paid for by you and I.
Oh, tell me about it. I know that.
No money for the poor.
That's right. That's right.
Dickens, where are you when we need you?
Yeah, I know. So what happened
but
to that bicycle?
That's a reality.
I want to go back to bicycle.
It was just the dream. It was just the biggest thing that ever happened to me. I remember it so well when I got that. And it was just, you know, until I was, I don't know, going to college or something.
What year, Harold?
I don't know. I would have been 13. What year? It would have been 1935, 48, 49.
48, 50. 49, because I remember my father buying in 1946, he bought a new Chevrolet, a fleet line, maroon, beautiful car. For $500.
Yeah.
Yeah, a brand new car. I think it was around $500.
That would be a lot of money then.
Yeah, a fortune.
And I think it's probably stayed pretty close to the thing with the inflation and everything like that, actual buying power of what it is.
Yeah, beautiful, gorgeous little car.
But after the Second World War, by the time that they got a chart. David McReynolds, great guy. War Resisters League, great guy, great friend of Allen Ginsberg and the Beats, Ray Bremser and all the Beats and all those people that were poets and all along. And he's got a chart that shows that almost 65% of the budget, national budget. And he's got a chart, you know, a pie chart.
Yeah, yeah.
And you got over here Social Security, and this is something for somebody who's poor, and this is something to help somebody who's a kid needs it in order to not die from some little thing that could be handled, but you don't can't got the right insurance or some bullshit thing the people.
Yeah.
And 65% of it is for the military. And they're going to upgrade, I'm not sure, they're going to refurbish. The real danger to the world, and it's mostly in the United States of America, the Trident fleet. Those are the deep underwater submarines with the thermonuclear capacity to deliver down on anybody who would dare stand up to us.
To
keep the military power in the hands of the United States. They're going to massively give more to the military.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that submarine or that ship that I don't know if it was. No, it's not a submarine. It was like a. Like a battleship. A battleship. It was a prototype.
Yeah.
A prototype.
Yeah.
And I don't know if they're going to make any more. I mean, the cost is exorbidant. But I'm sure maybe the other countries are going to maybe start making them.
Well, China's doing a lot, and that's going to be a big issue.
I know.
But anyway, he had that. And there, during the war with the fascists and everything, then he had a chart. The percentage of the budget that went to war, as opposed to things that can serve some living repurpose or for the poor or the masses, it went to absolute zero. There was nothing in the fight against Nazis and Mussolini and all that, fascism, which is a lot of people think is a danger of coming again. But anyway, that's only where it went. All during that war, there was nothing. So all the items that normally come in new each year were put on hold. There was nothing, so everybody driving old cars.
Yeah,
but wait, we won the war.
Yeah.
So if you win the war, then you can write the terms. And yeah. So from the 45 to 65, 70, well, magic time in America, magic time.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
Everything, you know, the war was no over, so they started making new products and everything, and money actually got to people.
Yeah, I know.
So a lot of people who had been working class and all that became easily middle class, comfortable, not alienated, not messed up in their head, anything like that. It was a wonderful time,
yeah, yeah.
25 years after the war.
You know, but before
that's when we came into our maturity.
Yeah, but I remember,
that's
you know.
That's why we're so good.
Harold, I remember collecting tin cans.
Yeah.
Tin cans.
Yeah,
and they crushed
yeah.
them.
Yeah.
And right. they had a
victory guard.
We had a victory guard, everything. Collect them and everything else. My mother was working in a defense plant.
Yeah.
Everybody
was in sync with
yeah,
everybody
yeah.
else.
There was no motor cars yeah. made 43, 44, 45.
That's what I said. Nothing.
Yeah, nothing was made because every.
No refrigerators, nothing. It was all.
For
gun.
War. Yeah, yeah, it was for war, for tanks, 60, for everything.
65% of the whole national budget is war.
That's right. Exactly
and they're
right.
They're going to expand it.
Yeah.
It's crazy
yeah.
in a certain sense.
Yeah.
But my. The dentist lived next door to mine. My dad was a lawyer. And the dentist lived next door. They were the first one. We were in a. Middle class thing in Detroit, and they were the first ones in the neighborhood to get an automobile in the year 1946. They got
the same. Like I told you, yeah.
It seems like you got good genes, like I did.
Yeah, yeah, I know.
Well, at least my best friend Bob McKnight, who was my best friend, right next door, was his dad was a dentist. Anyway,
they
got a Dodge. It's 1946 Dodge, and it was the talk of the neighborhood.
How much they pay for it, do you remember?
I have no idea. It's meaningless because it would be all comparable to what, and then the market could come in, and they started turning it out afterwards. But that was something. And then we got a television set. They bought a television set in anticipation.
With the round tube?
I'm not sure if it was or not. I don't remember that well.
Was it a Dumont Herald?
They got a television set and they put it in the corner of the living room.
Yeah.
And Danny, there was a little bit New York. You know, New York always leads.
Okay.
And then Hollywood.
Okay.
But in Detroit, there was literally no television programming at all. So we put this anticipation and thinking ahead and capability that's coming over the horizon and all that positive stuff. So everybody got to be where they were making real money and they could become middle class and everything. But anyway, and there was no programming. They had a test pattern with an Indian head.
Yeah,
and
right.
we looked at the damn test pattern.
Yeah. But the army
had, we saw.
The army had them. The army had the TVs in the 40s.
Well, I'm talking 46.
Yeah,
right
yeah.
after the war.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But
they put it in the corner. There was no television. Then came Howdy.
And then when Milton Berle? Milton Berle came out when?
I don't know. It would have been after that. Might have been in New York.
Yeah.
There was some New York, California, Los Angeles.
Okay.
That always leads and everything. But like that was all. That was a film process.
Okay. Yeah, that's right.
It was
I remember.
A film, kinescope.
I remember.
Yeah.
I remember the. I think it was the Magnavox or the Philco or the Dumont. The Dumont came in with the big wooden thing with the round screen. It was a round little. It was like a porthole.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was the TV.
Yeah. But the point being is that finally there came. The beginning of the early programs were all kinescope, like shows and stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
Things
yeah.
from the network. But then it got to be where it was television built, and you had to vet things. You had to know how do you see history. You could not do that in 1890. We didn't have anything. We had smoke signals. Okay, the capability. We didn't know electricity.
We had Abe Lincoln. Didn't we have Abe Lincoln?
Well,
when did he come in?
We had photographs. photography came in terms of the technological involvement.
Okay.
But it was all growing, and it came out of that. So it was a golden era.
Yeah.
But we had this television set, and then it finally started. It started coming. But that's what happened. That was the media, and it was a golden era. But right now. I think you're right about the fact that the exponential, you know, exponential is not 1, 2, 3, 4, it's 100, 200, 400, 800, etc. Exponential with the the development of the information technology, and it's migrating quickly in the market and so forth into robotics. You're absolutely right.
Oh, yeah.
It'll be doing all kinds of things that people used to have to go in mines, deep mines, and do all kinds of grubby stuff. And they had to do it in order to get resources, and they won't have to do that. And it's creating a huge collective capability for people living a good life that becomes capable that was never possible out of everything in history.
Harold,
we're transcending history in a major way beyond just some political change of a
political
party.
Harold, can you picture a robot going into a deep mine, digging for gold and stuff like that, and then the walls collapse on top of the robot, then it's gone?
Yeah.
So they
well, there would be a cost-benefit relation to what the cost of the robot was to how many guys you could hire to go there and do all that stuff because they're desperately getting food for the kiddies. They won't die of starvation. It's so ugly.
Yeah.
History is a nightmare of inadequacy, injustice, zero sum for one to win. Somebody had to lose and that.
Yeah.
And we're maybe transcending that.
Well, what
at a cosmic level.
Harold, what do you think is going to be coming for us soon?
Well, I don't know for sure. I'm very worried about those tridents and the same old rules of who rules is the guy who's got the biggest club hits the other guy in the head, invent some sort of creation story, get some soldiers to protect him, and get people like that, and then they make a country. And then they've got interests that they have, and then in order for them to grow, they hit the other guy on the head. And it's called war. And it's still way in which
war.
The international...
War. We got war now.
Who's on top? It's like a heavyweight boxing champion for some bullshit. Excuse my language.
Yeah, we're going
but
through...
But it really is, and they're just there. And on the reverse side, there's a capability of providing for everybody that has never, even in the wildest dreams, thought of to be... They used to have to carry buckets of water up dark stairwells in Edwardian England to pour a little bucket of water in circle without nobody could see them. Up these things, wait a minute, and pour it into the tub for warm water about 10 times. Women they had doing it.
That's right.
So they could take a bath. Now, even in New York, you turn a button, it's good water. And you can make it available to everybody. You can make warm water of it. That's a big jump in terms of improving the material assistance. And if we take it for granted, then they have highways and things that have grown up.
I know, Harold, carrying warm water.
Collectively.
Harold, we go back a long way.
Yeah.
Don't you remember, in the 1940s, we used to buy ice from an iceman.
Of course.
And he used to carry the ice on his back.
They had a little cart, a square thing.
Yeah.
25, 50, 75, 100. That was 25 pounds, 50. They put it in the window.
That's
and
right.
They would get it, and they had a big canvas thing over the back of the cart being pulled by a horse.
Yeah, that's right.
And
they used to carry it up the steps.
They'd take it with those thongs.
Harold, in the 1940s, my parents and myself, we lived in like a railroad shack for $27 a month rent. Was $27
$27
a month rent. The ice man, we had not a refrigerator, it's ice box. Ice box.
Of course, they didn't have a refrigerator.
We were
all
on
the
we
things
were,
that are coming in the modern world may had come in abundance for
that's
everybody.
Right. The man used to carry it on his back with the big things like this.
Mm-hmm.
On his back, walk up 3-4 flights of stairs and put it right in. The ice box would open from the top.
Yeah.
That
was the only way you could get there.
Put
that
it right in.
The only way you could get it there.
You couldn't get it there any other way.
No, you had to do a lot. But now you can get it easily. And they'll be bringing ice cubes to your little thing where the robot will bring it into the thing. You open the door and it'll be delivered to you. And all these things are going to happen or could happen. And let's hope they can get their act in order before, in the angst of the fighting that still modifies, that still characterizes the world.
But Harold.
Before, the danger is the unleashing of the Trident submarines in the behest of the United States of America. Something China does, or somebody says, I can't stand it, and it doesn't go. Let's just, like that, set it off. And the research, you got to look it up and get to chapter and verse. It would mean the end of every single human being. If that is unleashed, that weapon that collectively
didn't Nostradamus say that in 2020 or 20 something, the world would come to an end? Do you remember that?
Nostradamus was a kook.
You think he was a kook?
Yeah, I think he was a kook.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he had some powers or something, like Jane Roberts or something.
All right, okay.
Spiritual people. You know.
Okay.
But he did say it, and he did have an uncanny ability to con princesses and things like that who had the power, and he was able to be a con man.
Yeah. You think he was a con man, Nostradamus?
Well, that's my thought. No, I'm probably wrong. I don't have a lot of respect for the spiritual tradition.
You don't, because there's two sides to every story, Harold.
Well,
you could be
true.
Right, you could be wrong, it could be anything.
Absolutely. The universe and everything in it is what they call synergetic.
Yeah.
That's the behavior of systems unpredicted by the sum of its parts. You get a maximally engaged system, like, say, a guy's in jazz. You probably hang around a lot of jazz musicians or jazz sessions.
Oh, I used to. Jazz musicians? Yeah. Oh, for God's sake.
It's called a jam session.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
And the guys are playing. They don't know what the hell they're going to do. They get out there and they start going and they meet with this and they feel that tone. And then you just get to a thing where everybody's jamming, and then some son of a gun goes up another level, over, and then everybody comes up to that when it's a spontaneous happening.
Yeah, yeah.
Now that's creative.
Yeah, but
what we need for the whole human society.
Harold, when we used to have jam sessions, there was no charts, always head charts.
Absolutely no
charts. Always head charts.
If you had to charge money, below contempt.
No, but I'm not talking about charts. I'm talking about charts, music charts.
Oh, charts.
Everybody got together after they did their nightclub shows.
Yeah.
All right? And you used to go to a restaurant or go to someplace else or go to a lounge or go to someplace else. And they used to get together. One guy used to sit down at the piano. One guy used to bring a saxophone, a trumpet, And they used to play just off the top of their head, and everything used to work beautifully.
Yes, right.
They used to make it up as they went
along.
That's
a good metaphor for, let's say everybody in the world is in that kind of a position where they don't have to be beating anybody in the head, they don't have to degrade themselves to get anything to eat, they don't have to do all the things the masses of the world have had to do on the history of the world by the few people who always ruled, and the ruling was, and the understanding was, there's not nearly enough. If you get anything, that means I lose. If you win, I lose. If I win, you lose. And it's not enough. It's called realpolitik. It still holds. It's still being manifest every day in the news by the people fighting over it, and it's still arguing about outdated realities at the level of capability. No, it'll dawn someday. It's going to dawn. It'll come on like a gangbuster.
Yeah.
That there is enough.
There is
enough. There's never been enough.
Harold.
At the material level in all of 200,000 years of human existence. Never enough.
Yeah.
Always, collectively, in terms of the collective capability. There has been since about the time of 60, about 70.
Time of 60, during World War I, World War II.
No.
Everybody did not have enough.
No.
Everybody fought over money and power.
Well, they
all money and power. The same thing. All right.
Same thing.
I want all the money you got, and I want to have all the power to control everything.
And if you got the guns and soldiers, you've got the means of having the power.
Never. Why don't people just say, "Listen, why don't?"
Because there never has been enough. In order for a mother to steal, there's only one little cup of milk, and there's 16 children over here, right on the verge of death. She will kill to get that to give to her child because there's not enough for 16. So that's the reality you have to come to accept.
Okay, I'm glad that you brought that. Harold, I'm glad that you brought that up because my grandfather, during wartime, I think it was maybe during World War I, during World War I, I think it was, when he came from the old country, all right?
Yeah.
The people that were hiding, the Germans were trying to kill them, were trying to murder everybody and take over.
Is it World War I?
It was World War II, maybe. World War II. Maybe World War II.
They both were just horrible.
Horrible. Wait a minute.
Horrible beyond belief.
He had one room. He had 16 people, just like you said, 16 people. And he was running around stealing a loaf of bread to feed everyone to keep them alive.
Yeah. Yeah, Jean Valjean.
Stealing a loaf of bread. And they were, the authorities were looking for him to kill him.
Well, that's what comes, that's what the danger of fascism is. Yeah. When one gets a thing and then they got all kinds of power. They think they got the truth and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's not being synergistic. You keep these people out and all identity politics and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
And everything. But anyway, it's got a timing of its own, it would seem, which seems odd that we, maybe you and I, there's been about 10,000 generations, a generation.
No, we're only, what, 3 years apart, 4 years apart?
I'm talking about the human society.
Okay, all right, okay.
We appear out of evolution about 200,000 years ago in Africa. We're all out of Africa. We're all descended of Africa. They migrated out around the world. We know it scientifically and everything like that. And different races develop and all that. It's about 10,000 generations. That's a lot. And we, you and I, and my son and daughter and that and everything, but we particularly being older, were happened to be born into the moment in evolutionary terms when we crossed in our collective capability, collectively done like a scientific measuring of capability, not we crossed the 50% term point in collective capability, which we couldn't even see or anything like that, to where there were more, by definitions that have to be drawn upon and codified and everything, but there's been done by some, that we crossed on a world scale within the ecological context, the ironclad laws of scarcity, and that happened, a higher percentage on world terms. It was about 10-20% in 1920 or something, and it got to be about 30, and it got to be at of the percentage of the world population in terms of capability capable of being able to see a way in which they become a have as opposed to a have not. Always been overwhelmingly more have nots. You could do anything you want with
it.
If you're in the Duke or something.
Yeah, all right, Harold.
But anyway, they crossed the 50% mark in our lifetime. In the 10,000th generation, which means you got a situation where for the first time in evolutionary terms, we do not have to be blinded by the theory of zero sum, for one to win, another to lose. We have transcended to where the capability is such, on a positive vein, where everybody, every single human being, can be seen to be, we have the ability to make every single human being on the planet a have by a definition of terms, rather than only a chosen few. That we would be born into the defining generation after 10,000, you and I, and all the kiddies, of qualitative, not quantitative, not a small climb up a ladder, but a qualitative, like punctuated equilibrium is the way the new appears in evolution. It's a moment where you have a pregnancy, you're in a state, and then you come into a new way. Evolution, that's the way the new species appear. That's, we came out of Homo erectus 200,000 years ago. So we were born into that qualitative moment of incredible capability to transcend scarcity as an ontologic reality. And once you get to that, it only grows. And there's more and more capability, and you're coming into a time we can annihilate.
We can do anything.
We can annihilate the Homo sapiens species. You can do testing. Tridents are the main. The atomic weapons, which is the hitting the guy in the head business of realpolitik. Whoever's got the gun can rule. And everything, and to where we can annihilate, or we have the ability truly, in a material sense, not in some dream thing or something like that, or if I get the bet, liberate in a real way the whole of the human society. And our generation is dawning. It's not able to be encompassed in anybody's thinking because they're so imbued with the old lines like Constitution and this and that and this and that and this tax cut or that or everything. But that is the thing that's growing apace, whether we like it or not. That's what's going. The danger is, the likelihood is, probably is, we're going to annihilate the whole species rather than do and take advantage of the capability to make everybody a have materially. If everybody's a have, nobody's worrying about who's going to steal my butter or whatever. You know what I mean? No, that's a wrap. I do it too much. But yeah, I think to be born into that generation is incredible. We've had 10,000 generations at 20 years a generation something.
Did you ever trace back to your?
Well, yeah, I did. I have done it. Everybody can do it now. You can trace your genes.
What did you find, Harold?
Well, I found, I was just looking at it the other day.
Yeah,
the guy Spencer Wells. There's all kinds. What's his name? The richest guy. The Microsoft guy.
The Microsoft?
Bill Gates.
Bill Gates.
His wife is very much involved in it. They got a thing, 21 or something. And you can have your DNA done. And that gives you a reading of your past, the DNA, scientifically, not some story about Uncle Bill did something.
Yeah.
Or something. But, yeah, and you can do that. I did it with Spencer Wells about 10 years ago. And you get, they have on your DNA markers. And a marker is a thing that reads back through your past experiences in a scientific way with validity. And the marker showed, in my case, that it went back to 60,000, an individual. And everybody ought to do it.
It's
easy. It'll get down to cost. They'll do it free. They'll probably do it to everybody. Yeah. It's a couple of $100 or something. But you go and you go back and they got, they could, because everything's going to go down in cost that way. But anyway, because the information technology is going to make it. Do you understand? There's economies of scale.
Yeah, all right.
Okay. That would be a good thing to do, as well as translate all the languages of the world one into another autonomically. That would be great to get over the language barrier between human beings. That would be wonderful, I think. But anyway, so you have markers. There were four or five in mine, and that it means me as an individual here relating to an individual. For men, it's on the Y chromosome. For women, it's mitochondria. They can trace it. The markers.
The women they could trace, but
with
the
mitochondria.
Can they trace the men's?
Yes, on the Y chromosome.
Okay, all
and
right.
And what you do is you take a little swab,
yeah,
and you send it in, and they send you back a history of your ancient reality, not myth about this tribe or that tribe or whatever, reality of a person that existed in the past, related to you in your line of development. So I did, and the one that went back the furthest was me. It went back to me as an individual, to a person that existed in reality 80,000 years ago.
What?
Yeah.
80,000?
That was a marker. It was 80 or 60. I can't remember.
Okay.
Okay. And it locates it geographically where that person was. You could do it with yourself. You have a relative of yours 60,000 years ago existed, and that marker put you in touch with that in scientific, realistic, accurate terms of your lineage, okay?
How sure are you that this is the truth? Maybe it's not the truth.
Well, it's scientifically, okay, there's a thing called science. And they have testing they do.
Okay.
It's been tested.
All right.
It's valid, okay? It's valid. It's not conjuring or something like that. Or
but
making,
are they doing or, it? Are they, is this a scam or something?
No, you sound like a New Yorker.
Well, of course I am a New Yorker, Harold.
You don't trust your fellow man?
I mean, how can they go back to 60,000 years?
Go home and look on your computer and look it up. You can do it. You can do geographic. It's Geno something. And then the wife of Bill Gates is now doing it. They'll be getting down to where they do it too. If you just want to know, it's scientifically valid. And it was 60,000 or 80,000 years. And that was in what is Ethiopia, in Africa. A person, male, existed that is in my line, for myself, who is here now, a male. Then there was another marker. It was in what's like Iraq. That was another person in my lineage. That was maybe 15, or, you know, coming more. Then there was another one, there's about six, and these are scientifically, and they said it's all true. There was another one in the Balkans, you know, in Yugoslavia or something. Then there was another one that was in the south of France. That would be an individual male. The women can do it with an individual woman. You don't know whose name or what or anything, you know.
Oh, there's no names or anything?
No. How are you going to have a name?
So how can you trace it and how can you make sure?
They're tasting the marker on your DNA. We don't know about DNA for the last couple of years. So I'm telling you, it's a quickening, like a pregnancy. It's coming to where our capability is just becoming amazing. And then I had the last one was, it's got a number and it's got a thing and they explain it, what it means. That was a group that went up into Britain and Ireland and a branch to Scandinavia. And that was, I don't know, 20, 30, you know, very recent, okay? But you can trace your lineage that way.
Wouldn't you like?
And it's everybody should do it. That will begin to get the human society together, knowing your roots, not all the baloney stories, I would use the term that goes BS, that is made up by all the people who've used that kind of interest and that kind of background, wanting to know what's life about, in order to form some spiritual something or other, that my spiritual thing's better than yours, and all of the fighting and everything, which is a danger to unleashing those God-blessed trident suburbs.
Harold, wouldn't it be interesting if not only have they got these markers, but if you've got branches of the other people where you have relatives that you know nothing about and they know nothing about you, how would you find them?
Well, I don't know. They go through a rigorous thing in order to identify it, so it's not bullshit conjuring. My relative's better than yours, or mine was the king of the castle, so I'm going to be the king, and I have a right to be there, and this, and all the argument over material scarcity.
Yeah.
There's not enough. We're going to get to a world where there is enough, materially,
enough
for all. So then you can have a gigantic jam session. Do you understand what I'm saying?
A jam session.
You
don't
have to be robbing Peter to pay Paul.
Oh, that'd be wonderful.
Yeah. No, it's in the car.
There would be no wars at all.
You don't know what it would be. One would hope we could annihilate or liberate the human society to a new order of being material and spirit. And I don't like spiritual, but existence that is transcendent to the human society. Not in a political context or a historical context, but in a global or evolutionary. We're coming to the end. There's a term, synergy, behavior systems. When the guys hit high C or gals or whatever, hit high C in the group. That, you know what I'm talking about. It happens to you all the time. I bet it happened to you all the time.
No, I never hit high C. A flat or A sharp was the highest that I could go.
A flat?
Yeah, A flat.
Oh, no, you're not an A flat guy.
No, that's three octaves above. Then I go three octaves and one note down.
You sing like Mel Torme better. You're better than Mel. I heard you down there singing. You didn't know I was hearing.
Oh, Harold.
Yeah, you're a hell of a guy.
Oh, Harold.
Anyway, synergies, behavior systems, unpredicted by the sum of the parts. There's something resonatingly more than a maximally engaged system becomes new.
Yeah.
It's something more than the sum of the parts. So when we get humanity liberated, there will be a resonance. And it creates a synergy, a resonancy more than the sum of the parts, and it's mystery. We don't know. We can't know what that is because it emerges out of the past into the new, and you don't know what the new is. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Harold,
an epiphany.
Harold, there was a guy named George Soros. You know George Soros? He wanted to allegedly control the entire world. And he had the world, the new order, which you mentioned.
You mean the guy uptown here?
No, not the guy uptown. The guy that was running around all over the country and so on and so forth. You mentioned the new world order before.
Yeah, well, that was a term the Republicans used.
He wanted to create.
Bush,
he wanted to create the new world order.
Well, there people will do that. People will promise you everything.
Yeah,
like
they'll
that,
promise you
know?
Everything, give you nothing.
My God's better than yours.
I know, yeah.
That's what they've been arguing for 2,000 years.
My God is better than you. Listen, I've been...
If you're in a jam session, is the trombone better than the piccolo or what?
How piccolo? Don't play the piccolo.
Well, they could if you were really good.
Yeah,
they'd
pick it up. A trombone, different sounds entirely.
You're not listening to what I'm saying. It's the synergy is the jam session.
Okay.
You're doing it. You're in sync with the guy, and the guy goes up a little bit, and then God damn, let's stay here.
Yeah.
It's easy to go bump, 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 and he wants to go bump, 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 bump. And, you know, and that's how the new appears. And that's how species appear evolutionarily.
Oh, speakeasies.
No, species. Our species is Homo sapien.
Okay.
Sapien.
Okay.
And we came on the scene about 200,000 years ago out of evolution.
Okay.
Now we're coming to the end of that. And if we get our act together, there will be a resonancy like a gigantic jam session of a liberated, unselfish, ungreedy, all that kind of stuff, human society, the whole society of the world.
Harold, I hope it happens.
They can realize their full potential.
I hope it happens. But
and there will be a resonancy, a synergies behavior system unpredicted by the sum of the parts. There will be a resonancy. That's what the high note when you get to the high point of the jam session. There will be a resonancy that will interaccommodate us to the universe at a level transcendent to what we've been through 200,000 years. We're going to come into a new relationship with the higher order. We don't know what it is.
Okay. Do you think the wars that are going on all over the world are going to stop?
Well, I pray that they will.
Yeah, so do I.
No, I'm serious.
Yeah.
I mean, you can look it up. The weapons are capable of, mostly in the hands of the United States of America. They don't have a vision.
Oh, wait a minute.
They don't have vision of something other than war.
Everyone's got nuclear weapons now.
No, they don't. They don't know. The real danger is America, by and large. Okay. They're the ones who've got the real boom. There's a few little nuclear weapons, a couple hundred in Pakistan. That could be dangerous.
In Russia? What do you think about Russia?
Russia, they have some, yeah.
And what about China?
Yeah. Well, they have some, but not that much.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Pakistan and India is particularly dangerous. There's such deep animosity.
What about North Korea?
North Korea is an oddball.
An oddball, a real oddball.
Well, all of this is part of it, yeah.
Yeah.
But so that's the condition we were born into. You could have been born into the 6th century, and it took 2,000 years to invent a tack. You're so slow. You were in a Cro-Magnon cave. You had a rock. You'd protect it because it gave you a little advantage over the other person.
Harold,
you could cut some meat. Or
that's
something.
The reason there's so much corruption going on.
Well, corruption is in the eye of the beholder. I mean, corruption is another matter. It's just cheating and stealing and anything to get the leg up and all the political stuff.
They never have enough. They want more.
Well. That maybe, because one thing, that's what has ruled. That's been the means by which somebody has some say
over
what's going on.
The countries, most of the countries allegedly are corrupt.
Well, this country's corrupt.
Definitely so. Definitely so.
Core.
Yeah.
62 people have the wealth of half the population.
That's right.
You had Trump rolling on that. Trump was trying to touch into that. There's a sense of
wait. Trump isn't in office yet.
No, but that's all right.
You have to wait till he gets in office.
He rode on the discontent that is manifest and felt throughout the world, and so did Bernie Sanders. They came from both sides. They're not satisfied with the status quo. There's something rotten in Denmark, they say.
Something rotten.
Well, you remember that with Mr. Shakespeare. I didn't mean to carry on.
No, that's all right, Harold. You did beautifully.
You should go home and look up and get yourself a marker.
A marker.
Yeah, you just shake.
But what do you do? You just take a little swab. And
you,
what
your
do you
cheek,
do?
And then you put it in a thing, and it closes it, and you send it off.
And they send you back.
And they send you all the literature about it.
How much does that cost? What do they charge you?
I don't know. It was a little bit then, but I think they're going to probably make it free.
Really?
You got eroding costs coming all over the place.
Yeah, yeah.
So that would be a great boom. And that would get people thinking larger term rather than narrow term of what the
trace
reality
your whole
is.
History back with that marker.
Well,
with that.
As an individual.
Yeah,
to
yeah.
To an individual that existed 80,000 years
yeah.
ago.
Yeah, but
where they were.
But Harold, I would love.
They're going to trace the whole population
Harold,
of the
I,
planet.
But I would love to have the whole package. I would love to have the people that the sperm all the tentacles. I want to see all the tentacles from each individual person.
Know.
See,
yeah.
I would love to see that.
Well, I don't know. I've been doing other things and everything, but I was amazed by it, and now it's just becoming something that'll become universal.
Yeah, yeah.
The cost will be zero, I would think.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't cost that much.
Yeah.
For one tank or something.
But Harold, would you like to be a relation of Putin? Would you like to be a relation of Truman, of Roosevelt, of all these people? Would you like to find out who these people exactly, were?
I'm not sure they can do that. I don't think they can do that. They can do a person that existed.
A person,
there were no
but the names,
they didn't
though.
Write anything down.
But
they made spear points. No, names. You don't have names of somebody. It's just a male who
oh,
was
it's
there
just a male.
In Ethiopia.
No, I want the names.
Well, okay,
I want
well,
the people. I want to know
well,
what the people were like, what they did.
Well,
what
the danger of that is that would take another layer of understanding and everything like that, and there would be somebody would come up with another religion or something who would say, my religion's better. Or
it's
I'm
all
tied
the same.
Into this guy.
Harold.
You're talking about history. I'm talking about prehistory.
Okay, all right. Harold, I've been to every church, Harold. I went to Baptist church. I went to Catholic church. I went to every church.
Why did you move around so? Why didn't you find the one great, true, honest to God religion and line and telephone line to God?
Because I was curious, and Harold, I wanted to see what what the
Merry
difference.
Christmas.
What Merry Christmas to you too, darling. I wanted to see what everything was all about.
Yes.
And there's no difference.
What's it all about,
there's
Al?
No difference.
No,
it's the same.
No.
It's all the same. It's a different style.
Well, okay.
It's all a different style.
Well, you're trying to bring it into the human condition as we understand it out of history. They got books and they.
Yeah, it's a different style, but everything is basically the same.
Well, okay, but I think we're going to find that it's not individuals or something. You're going to see the whole pattern of the whole evolutionary page. I mean, they come now to understand it. We didn't know anything 100 years ago. We were ignorant fools. And so we were susceptible to all kinds of people saying, my religion is better than yours, and this land is mine, and I better get my land to give my kid, or the other, he's going to die because there's not enough. And all the argumentation over scarcity, and the major thing you're going to find is that there is enough.
Harold.
And growing enough.
Harold.
So that when you have enough, you're not going to be doing the kind of silly things like blowing up the world.
All right.
Or feeling the need to.
Do you?
All the hatred that let loose in politics.
Do you believe that every administration wants to keep the public, the people, completely ignorant?
They might, to their advantage. They might have a lot of that kind of thing. It's very narrow, and it's tradition. You can understand it.
Yeah.
I'm just suggesting it's something else.
Yeah, all right.
That's all.
All right.
But I think we're born into that time, maybe. I ain't got too much time left. I hope I can see. I hope I can see some evidence of understanding things that way. That would be the path toward a massive liberation that would inter-accommodate us to universe at a level, a collective universe, like a big, gigantic, hitting high C jam session.
Of the world,
which will be resonating. There will be a resonancy of a collective whole that will inter-accommodate us because the universe is set up like that out there, out in space. It's inherent in the universe, the way new things appear, how life started. There's a tie into it all.
All right.
And we're born into this period.
So
one thing is the problem. We got to wish all the kiddies.
Yeah.
Get thee to the Christmas tree or to the Hanukkah bush. What do you have, a Hanukkah bush?
Hanukkah bush.
What, do they have a Hanukkah
bush? Well, it's a Christmas bush, too.
No, what is Hanukkah?
Everything's a bush, Harold.
We, in Christianity, have a Christmas tree with a Santa Claus on top.
Yeah. Is it a white Santa Claus or a black Santa Claus?
Well, you only got 10 seconds.
We have 10 seconds. God bless you. Everyone loves you, Harold.
Tiny Tim. God blesses one and all. Happy holidays.
Happy holidays.
Push the envelope. Be creative. Yeah. Stay out of trouble if you can.
Yeah, and if you can't be good, be careful.
Thank you.
Thank you, Harold.
We agree. Happy Christmas.
You too, Donald.
Yeah. Okay, well, that's it, huh? Right? Is that's it?